so that we may bring you the following special. Tornadoes on Trinity Bay is brought to you by New Bud Dry. The smooth, clean taste comes on strong, then it's gone. And by Aetna, the insurance company that gives new meaning to the word diligent. And by British Airways, with service through London to 147 cities worldwide.
Hello and welcome to the 1989 Tornado World Championships. I'm Steve Mark. We're on the lawn of the Houston Yacht Club, and all around us, 76 international competitors getting their boats ready for the first race of a seven-race regatta. But before we get underway, let's talk a bit about these speedy 20-foot catamarans.
A relatively light boat for its size, the Tornado has a beam 10 feet wide, a 30-foot mast, weighing in around 350 pounds. The total sail area is 235 square feet.
The boat is capable of speeds that are quite a bit higher than the normal single-hulled sailboat. Roughly in the 20 or 25 mile an hour category, these boats can, under the right conditions, pull a water skier to give an idea of the speed that they have.
About 70% of the power in the Tornado's sail is in the mainsail. The rotating mast actually becomes part of the power of the sail, creating a more potent wind foil. The helmsman controls the mainsail through the main sheet. It pulls on the boom and allows the sail to be pulled in or eased out.
This in and out motion is what you will see when people are trying to get the absolute speed out of the boat. In and out all the time, trying to keep the boat just flying one of the hulls in order to have the maximum possible forward push.
The forward sail is called the jib, and while it's the smaller of the two, the wind gets here first, so it really controls the efficiency of the rest of the rig. The crew controls this sail through the jib sheet system. Tiny continuous adjustments of this sail are important for maintaining maximum speed. The boat is at its maximum when one hull is flying just above the water. The crew member attached to the boat with a trapeze harness will extend themselves off the side of the boat to maintain balance. In strong winds, the helmsman also moves to the side as the catamaran flies across the water.
So while racing, each of the two team members has primary responsibility for one of the two sails. In addition, there are adjustments that can be thought of as shifting gears, if you would, in a race car. The sailor has to be able to take his boat into many, many different conditions. There's light wind conditions, medium, when it blows very hard, when the boat's going against the wind, or with the wind or on a reach. These are different conditions, sort of like drag racing or Grand Prix or sprints. You have to set up the boat to do different things on the fly. So there are, as you can see, a great many lines here, and what those are doing is allowing the sailors to change the way the airfoils are to shift gears on the fly, just like a race car driver might do in an auto race.
Sailing teams began arriving at Shore Acres last week and unloaded their boats from large shipping containers. But the official beginning of this world championship was the opening ceremonies held Sunday. The LaPorte High School marching band led the way for the 76 international sailing teams taking part in this regatta. The top Tornado sailors from 16 countries, including Australia, Canada, France, Italy, Germany, Russia, and the United States, have all gathered here for the 1989 World Championship. After the flag ceremony came the invocation.
We thank you for the rivers, lakes, and seas, pray for all who sail upon them. Bless these sailors as they travel upon the sea. Protect them afloat and ashore by day and by night, and bring us all to peace and security with you and all your saints. Blessed are you, Lord God, now, always, and forever. Amen.
Then event chairman Mike Bordelon welcomed the participants, families, and friends.
Bienvenidos. Willkommen. Willkommen. Bienvenue. Benvenuti. Willkommen, y'all.
Commodore Folke then spoke to the sailing teams.
On behalf of all the members of the Houston Yacht Club, I'd like to welcome you to this World Championship Regatta and welcome you to the Houston Yacht Club. We've all been looking forward to this event for 18 months as we've done our planning and made our preparations. And now the moment of truth has come for all of you. Our hearts go with you in this endeavor. We hope you have a safe regatta and wish you all fair sailing.
After a rousing flag drill presentation, hundreds of brightly colored balloons were launched and the regatta was underway. There were two practice races Monday and Tuesday. These races gave the competitors and the race committee a chance to check out the course before it really counts. These pre-races are optional, and the entire fleet of 76 Tornadoes didn't run on both days. One of the main concerns about running a regatta of this size is the starting line. In this case, a starting line is a half mile long. The sailing teams must line themselves between the two starting boats, being careful not to cross over the line. At the same time, race officials are sighting down the line, making sure no boats cross over. If a boat does cross before the warning signal, they are ranked with a premature start and automatically receive points equaling the number of boats in the race plus six. On Monday, the winds were light and shifty, so after officials had laid out the course, they determined that the race would be better served by a change in the course, and a new starting line was set up. Finally, the countdown began, and with the firing of the starting cannon, several boats surged over the line ahead of the signal. Officials called for a general recall, meaning that everyone has to return and start over. A few minutes later, the first pre-race is underway. As the race progressed, the winds picked up only slightly as fresh air crept slowly into the bay. On Tuesday, more than 50 tornadoes hit the bay for the second trial race. The non-existent wind delayed the beginning of this pre-race, and the postponement flag flew for more than 2 hours. After checking in, the sailing teams languished about waiting for the wind. Members of the French team took advantage of the warm Texas afternoon, and with their coach, jumped into the bay. Officials determined to run the start of the race and a shortened course. At least everyone could experience a starting lineup again. As the tornadoes approached the start line, many drifted over before the official signal and a general recall was ordered. A second attempt at starting also ended in a general recall. Okay, enough practice on the starting line. Finally, around 3:40 in the afternoon, nearly 2.5 hours after the scheduled start, the second pre-race got underway. Many of the international teams were using these pre-races to polish up their large regatta starting line skills and to discover what information they could about the Gulf Bay waters and breezes, so there was no disappointment when officials announced a shortened course. In fact, many boats dropped out before the race was over. And we'll be right back with the start of race one after these messages. Each race will be run on the same pattern with the actual compass headings determined by the wind. The tornadoes will start by sailing upwind and then around a triangular pattern, forming the first three legs of the race. Next, they sail two straight legs, then the triangle, two more straight legs, then back windward to the finish line. The longest leg is 1.66 nautical miles. In unfavorable racing conditions, the officials may alter the course by either shortening the length of the legs or reducing the number of passes to a minimum of six. About an hour before the start of a race, the race committee arrives at Trinity Bay. Wind measurements are taken and a course is determined. The marks are identified by bright orange buoys, and the compass heading is posted on the stern of the starting line boats. If the winds shift, the race course is also shifted so that the sailing teams can compete under the best conditions possible. When it is necessary to change the course, officials post a new compass heading and set a bright yellow buoy at the new mark. The old mark is then retrieved and the race continues without a pause. With two practice races under our belts, it's time to begin race number one of this regatta. The boats leave the Houston Yacht Club Harbor and head out across the ship channel to Trinity Bay. The first step for the tornadoes upon arriving at the race course is to pass by the starting line boat and check in for the race. The start of the race is delayed for a little more than an hour. The fleet of tornadoes silently drifting on the bay as everyone waits for the wind.
Well, one of those things, you gotta wait till the wind comes up. Can't race without wind, right?
Any good bucks lately?
Officials keep checking the wind direction, and as the winds reach 5 to 7 knots, decide to start the race. As the 75 tornadoes approach the starting line, officials watch carefully for any premature starts. 5 seconds from the start. 3, 2, 1. They're off. 8 boats cross early and they don't return as the individual recall when the individual recall signal is fired. The French team of Hervé Lurton and Fabrice Idier and Giorgio Zuccoli of Italy controlled first and second place through the first few legs of the race. At the second weather mark, French boat F210 with Alan Bornerel at the helm ran into the Eckards of Germany, knocking the starboard rudder and transom off the boat. The Eckards were forced to retire from the race. Off to a bad start, the Hagera brothers of Austria dropped into the middle of the fleet on the first leg of the race. But now with the seventh mark rounding, they're in sixth place, and it looks like they'll continue to pull ahead. Meanwhile, the French team is just doing an outstanding job in this race. Lurton and Idier of France have regained first place from Zuccoli and are pulling ahead on the ninth leg of the race. Behind them, Gabler and Parlow of Germany. But they are just one of the boats that jumped the start line and are likely to get a high score because of that, despite their finish line status. Only one more leg to the leeward mark and then straight on to the finish line. And Zuccoli look like they are first and second place wrapped up. However, a French and German boat are battling it out for third and fourth place. Gabler has been holding steady in third place for most of the race, but now the seventh team to cross the starting line, Clavinot and Eisenblatter of France, are closing in on them. And at the finish, it's Lurton and Idier, followed by Zuccoli and Glissoni of Italy. Clavinot pushes his boat over the line right in front of the Germans and takes third place. Let's take a look at the standings. Sixth place went to Italy, then the French helmsman, Lodan Bornerel, in boats 205 and F210. Ninth place goes to Goodall of Australia, and another Italian brings up the rear of the top 10.
On est super contents parce que c'est notre première, c'est un peu notre premier grand championnat tous les deux ensemble. Et en plus, c'est forcément la première manche d'un grand championnat qu'on gagne. On est super contents, quoi.
Total time for race one is 2 hours and 13 minutes. Again, Hervé Lurton and Fabrice Idier have taken the first race of the regatta. The days before and after the opening ceremonies were used by the contestants to check out their boats on the bay and scope out the competition. It was during these pre-race days that the boats had to be weighed and measured. The first official stage of the World Championship is the weighing in and measuring of the Tornado. Boats and masts are weighed. They must fall between 127 and 145 kilograms. That's a maximum weight of 319 pounds. If a boat is too light, corrector weights are added. Both the centerboards and rudders are measured against a template to assure accuracy. Differences in weight or size could give a boat an unfair advantage in the race. The sails are measured not only for width and height, but also for the amount of reinforcement. More than a dozen precise measurements are taken on the sails. A sailing team must have the mainsail and two jibs measured before the race. After a boat meets all these rigid standards, it receives an official stamp and then completes the first phase of the championship. With the French dominating the top 10 places, competition between the sailing teams is beginning to build. We'll return to the 1989 Tornado World Championship Regatta right after these messages. Welcome back to our coverage of the 1989 Tornado World Championship. Before race two gets underway, now might be a good time to explain the Olympic scoring system being used for this international regatta. First, low score wins, so the team with the fewest points will win the regatta and go home a world champion. A sailing team receives points for the place they finish in each race. For example, the winner of a race receives 0 points. Number two across the finish line receives 3 points. Number three receives 5.7. Fourth place equals 8 points. Fifth position is 10 points. Sixth gets 11.7. And seventh place and above received their place position plus 6. So a team finishing 10th would receive 16 points. The total score is based on the sum of the scores for all the completed races. Looking at our current leaders, you can see how the points add up. There is one loophole, however. A team can exclude their worst score. Remember, the lowest score wins the regatta. It's entirely possible with this scoring system that a tornado that comes in third or fourth consistently could walk away with the championship. So it's really a case of not being over till it's over. Heading into race number two, Lurton and Idier of France are in first place. Zuccoli and Glissoni of Italy follow as number two. In third place are Clavinot and Eisenblatter of France. The Schwalb brothers of Germany follow in the number four position, and in fifth place is the French team of Escarre and Deco. The second half of the top 10 reveals the obvious lead by the French teams. Today's weather is much like yesterday's. A very light wind is blowing as the tornadoes leave the harbor for the race course on Trinity Bay. All 75 boats check in with race officials, then wait an hour and 20 minutes for the race to start. A high-pressure area over the Texas coast is keeping the sea breeze from filing in until mid-afternoon. Finally, the starting sequence begins. As the countdown nears, almost half the fleet pushes over the line, forcing officials to call a general recall. A second attempt looks like it's going to be a clean start, but less than 30 seconds before the gun, the fleet presses forward over the line. Principal race officer Robert Matthews explains his next decision.
The black flag is put up because the fleet, in my opinion, was getting a little bit out of hand. They were being too aggressive at the start, and we had had two general recalls. That means we had more boats across the line than we could accommodate or identify, and we had two of those. And after the second one, I decided that since the line was the way it was supposed to be, it was their aggressiveness that caused me to put the black flag up. What that does is, for the next start, Anybody on the course side of the line in the last 3 minutes before their new start is disqualified. They're dead for that race. Not for the rest of the event, but for that race.
Back at the starting line, everyone is giving the black flag lots of respect. At the gun, all boats are clean except for Brazil 31, who is immediately disqualified. During the first three legs, the Hagera brothers of Austria take first place from the well-started French. Now in the middle of the race, the winds are picking up and building, and the Austrians maintain their lead with ease. Then on the seventh leg, Germany's Roland Gabler begins to make his move. Gabler catches up to the Hageras and beats them at the ninth mark.
The wind was coming new from the left side, and we dropped back to, I think, sixth place, sixth, seventh. But downwind, we made a good tactical thing, and just two rounds before the end, we pushed forward to the first position, and we hold it all the time long. We made a little bit distance to the second, and it was the Austrian, and then we bring it show home.
The Germans hold on to the lead and cross the finish line almost a full minute ahead of the 1987 world champions from Austria.
Yeah, I feel very glad because yesterday I finished four and was also very good for me. And after that, I know that we are disqualified. I was very sad, and I said, oh my, coming here, spent so many times here and preparing everything, and then in the first race disqualification for that. I think I'm not very happy. I know that we can do it because now we have five races on and we must see what is happened, and I hope the best, and we must see.
In third place, the Australian team of Booth and Forbes moving up from their ninth place start. Finishing out the top five, Germany's Schwall brothers and Pete Melvin and Chris Steinfeld of the United States. Sixth across the finish line was Germany's Justice Wolf, seventh. Eighth place went to the French, followed by the Sachs of Germany and then Le Putric in 10th place. With five boats in the top 10, it appears that the French team remains in control, but it's still anybody's regatta. We'll be right back with more sailing action as Tornadoes on Trinity Bay continues. Frequently in the United States, husbands and wives will team up for tornado sailing competitions, and it's not uncommon to see mixed crews on international boats. However, at this regatta, of the 76 teams competing, only four have women at the helm. Canadian Melanie Gummer has been sailing tornadoes since 1986, but she didn't take the helm until 2 years ago. It was the same year she came in second place at the Canadian Nationals.
You don't often see females skippering except in the female classes right now, but this is one boat that females can skipper and be quite successful at.
Johanna Kuzmin of Finland has been sailing since she was 6 years old. As she competes in the 1989 Tornado World's Championship, it is her 15th World and European regatta. Yet even with all that experience, she is still met with skepticism on the water.
In the beginning, they are afraid that I'm just going and hit their boats or something, but I think they have used me, and they are thinking that I'm like the others because I have been sailing Tornado 5 for seven years, but four or five years very, very much, and so I think they have got used to me all this.
Actually, this is the first race where we have met any other helmed women in Tornado
ever before.
We have been to all the worlds for a long while and all the European championships and everywhere in Europe and all that. We never seen another helmed woman before.
And I've been in US Open before here, and I've never seen anyone else help.
So we were surprised.
Yeah.
Johanna and her crew, Tommy Gustafsson, won the Finnish championship this year.
He's just giving me information what's happening, where's other boats, and how it looks there, and then I made a decision what we are going to do.
Yeah, that's basically it. I let her do it because she has more experience sailing. So it's not because, you know, she's a woman, I'm not, or whatever kinds of sex roles, or it's just because she's a more experienced sailor, she should do that.
Even here in the good old US of A, a helmswoman is not typical.
It's getting less and I guess, more and more usual. It used to be pretty unusual. I think there are four women sailing here. I think I'm probably the only female skipper on the U.S. sailing team that's not in a women's only class. But it shouldn't be unusual. Sailing's one of the few sports that men and women can compete equally, which is really nice, and there should be more of them doing it. And I think as they've opened up two, three women's only classes in the games, now it'll get more people involved sailing at that level. And once they get up to that level, they can move into the other classes and compete.
PZ Herndon has been sailing for most of her life. She met Olympic sailor Jay Glazer at the Goodwill Games in Russia in 1986.
So we've been kind of together since then. After the 88 campaign was over, we wanted a boat that we could sail together. He's been sailing Tornadoes forever, won a couple world championships, so it seemed kind of the natural boat for us to get into. We're a good size for it to sail together. We're tired of going different regattas in different ways all the time. We wanted to, instead of flying in and out, we'd go together. So it's been pretty fun.
When you have two people, you have a weight combination total. So if you have a light helms person and then a heavier crew, it's advantageous in the heavier air because you can get out on the wire. Okay, so that's a good weight combination. And females are light, and generally you want the lightness near the back of the boat.
In a regatta this size, it will be interesting to see how these ladies compete. Going into race three, Johanna is in 14th place. PZ is 20th, and Melody follows closely behind in 23rd place. All three are in the top third of the regatta. The light air, so apparent early this week, has been replaced by fresh breezes between 5 and 8 knots and building. Absolutely ideal conditions for today's race. Going into race three, our leaders are the Schwal brothers from Germany in first place, Klaveno and Eisenblätter of France, followed by their teammates, Lurton and Ideer, the winners of race one. Rounding out the top five is Zuccoli of Italy and another French team helmed by Yves Laudet. Absolutely ideal sailing weather today as the Tornadoes check in for race number three of the regatta. A steady wind of about 15 knots is coming from the southeast as the boats line up for the start of this race. At the gun, two boats cross early, Germany 911 and New Zealand 61. The New Zealand crew recognizes the individual recall signal and returns to cross over the starting line officially. The Australian team of Booth and Forbes immediately catch clean air and by the third mark are almost a minute ahead of the number two boat. At the fourth mark rounding, the Australians have stretched their lead to better than 2 minutes and are now so far ahead of the fleet, it seems no one will be able to catch them. Meanwhile, the battle for third place is getting heated as French, Russian, and German boats round the second weather mark. Halfway through the race, Frederick Lepotrick of France, who has been continually working his way through the fleet, pulls into third place and still more than a minute behind number two, his countryman Christoph Klaveno. The Russians settle into the fourth position, and the top four remain this way, valiantly pursuing the Australians. Australian boat all by itself. Unbelievably, Booth and Forbes crossed the finish line almost 3 minutes ahead of the fleet.
Well, the breeze was a little bit fresher right from the start, and once we had some clean air and a bit more strength, then we got a break straight from the word go. So we're first at the first mark, and the breeze stayed into the strength we like, so we're happy.
We've done nothing different for the last 6 months.
No, no, we just sail like we do at home. I don't know what the difference is. We're just happy to see that wind come in.
Klaveno of France crosses the finish line alone, also well ahead of his teammate Lepotrick. The Russians come next, crossing the finish line alone, and it's another minute before the rest of the fleet begins to approach.
We've got no superstition whatsoever. There's always a sailor superstition that if you win the practice race, then you won't have any luck at all during the series. So we went and proved that wrong today. We won the practice race and we won today. So pray for some more wind.
The Russians have really pulled ahead, but can these reigning world champions continue to work their way through the regatta? Australia, Germany, Italy, and the United States are all battling the French for lead position. We'll be right back with more tornado action after this.
The Tornado was first built back in 1966 in England. The advantage of this open-class catamaran is the ability for the boat to evolve over the years. One of the early creators of this design still sails Tornadoes, Reginald White of Brightlandsea, England.
The Tornado class is really more a formula than a specific boat. And as an open class, it is open to variable changes over the years. Reg White is the only one of the original creators of the Tornado that is still involved in the class.
Over the years, the boats were made of stress plywood. And that was very good at the time because an amateur could, you know, make his own boat, which is very good because boats are expensive, but of course people have got more affluent these days and we've had different types of hull shape, and the one we have right now has won six world championships. I guess that I always wanted to be a boat builder, so having done an apprenticeship for about 7 years, I gradually got into racing catamarans and got more and more into the design of it, and found that different things to do to them made them go faster.
Jorin Mardstrom of Sweden has sailed the Tornado in three Olympics, receiving the bronze medal in 1980.
Yeah, I'm building Tornadoes. So I started with that, I think, after the Olympics in Moscow, 1980. I thought I would like to have a very good boat. So I think the best way to get a good boat is to build it yourself. So that's where I started. So it took quite a long time to develop. The first boat was finished, I think, Christmas 83, just before the Olympics. 84.
You have to train hard, physically as well as mentally, and there's no shortcuts. If you put the time in, you should do well. But also, the Tornado is a very technical boat, and therefore you have to have a lot of technical backup. You know, you have to have the opportunity of purchasing the different types of masts that are on the market, the different type of sails that are available, and then you have to have a team to try the different equipment out and race one boat against the other, and that's very important. And I think that's probably one of the great contributions I can make with Rob, is that we can tune up against and sail together and try the different equipment out and decide, well, this sail is better than that sail. And it's very difficult to find a partner you can do that with.
One third of the 76 Tornadoes sailing in the 1989 World's Regatta were built by Reg White.
If you're going to sail, you have to do it night and day and live the part.
Someone who lives up to that belief is Olympic silver medalist Jay Glazer. Not only has he been sailing Tornadoes successfully for years, he also makes sails for the class.
So, well, we have a small sail loft, and we started it 2 years ago. Again, one of the sails that we make a lot of are Tornado sails, and it was something that we knew how to do really well. And it turned out that our sails were first and second in the Olympics, and they've done really well, and so people like them. They're fast. And what we try and do is to make a sail that is fast over a range of conditions. And I think some people, you can make a sail that's like fast in heavy air, fast in light air, or something like that. But we try and make a sail that's flexible enough that you can use it in 0 knots and use it in 30 knots just by changing a few little things. And so that's what you're always seeing people doing, is they're all trying to tweak their boats to tune them so that you can use them across the range of conditions. And that's pretty important because you're only allowed to measure one main. So if it blows hard, you got to use the same main you use if it, you know, blows like it did today, where it's light air.
Giorgio Zuccoli of Italy is another Tornado sailor that believes in the power of the sail.
I think that is very important, study sails that you have to use so you know everything and you can go faster. I think that if you make sails, you can also change the shape or the trimmer of a sail when you are out, because you know the possibility of one of a sail, and you need flatter sail, you can move because you know that.
Every one of the competitors in this regatta will be looking to make those slight adjustments in either their boat or their sail that can make the Tornado finish faster.
I think the most important on the boat is the crew, the helmsman and the crew, because all the boats here have a chance to win. It's not the boat, it's not the material who makes the winner, it's the people on board.
With Tropical Storm Jerry brewing in the Gulf of Mexico, race officials at the Houston Yacht Club have laid out various contingency plans for the regatta and the safety of the 75 Tornadoes. Let's check the current regatta standings going into race four. Clavenot of France is number one, finishing third, eighth, and second in the first three races.
I think it's more difficult in light wind because you, even if you are fast, you're not sure to be first because wind can change very quickly and it's hard to see the change. But we are, in fact, we are not afraid about the strength of the wind, so we feel safe.
The Frenchman is followed by the Schwal brothers of Germany, and right behind them is Giorgio Zuccoli, who had been picked as one of the favorites to win this regatta.
In any case, we won a lot of races in Italy and Europe last year and this year. Now, I hope this world can be very lucky, I hope. In any case, I don't stop here.
Next in line are the French in fourth and fifth place.
To win the championship, I'm not thinking about it now because it's so long, but I don't racing between people, against people. I'm racing against boat, and I don't thinking about the people who are on the boat on the sea.
In the second half of the top 10 is Goodall of Australia, Justice Wolf of Germany, Pete Melvin of the United States, the Russian team of Konovalov at the helm, and in the number 10 position, Spengler of Germany. It's a sunny Saturday afternoon, and the Tornado race course is surrounded by spectator boats. Currently, the winds are out of the northeast at about 15 knots as the Tornadoes complete the check-in and prepare for the starting sequence. The first start ends in a general recall as the fleet crosses the line too soon. A second attempt fails for the same reasons. Race officials taking new wind readings detect a shift in the wind direction. The entire course needs to be moved, so up goes the postponement flag. With the new course set, the race gets underway with a clean start. The U.S. team of P.Z. Herndon and Jay Glazer get off to a great start as one of the first three boats off the starting line. Then on the fourth leg, yesterday's winners, Australians Booth and Forbes, catch a clean spot of air and are off pulling ahead in much the same way as they did yesterday. At the same time, a second Aussie team is working its way through the fleet slowly. Zuccoli takes advantage of the wind and pulls ahead at the sixth mark rounding. As we approach the finish line, bearing down on the last leg of the race, several positions change hands. It's Australians in another showy finish. Mitch Booth and John Forbes sailed across the finish line about a minute ahead of the field. Countrymen Alan Goodall and Greg Cann are second, and the U.S. team, sailed by P.Z. Herndon, is a successful third. This is the best showing for a U.S. boat yet in the series. There are 17 boats from the United States entered in this regatta. 8 are from Texas, and 7 of those are from Houston. So our local contingent is large and well-deserving of some praise. U.S. sailing coaches Gordy Bowers and Jim Young do just that.
What makes a good sailing team? Well, time together is the obvious answer. You have to have that. These guys have put in a lot of effort, and you have to, first you have to have the abilities, the basic skill, you know, that's first base, I guess, if you will, and in order, you've got to be able to look in the mirror and say, hey, I'm good enough to win a world championship or a gold medal. And both guys have to do that because, as you said, it's a team. Both guys have to be very confident in their abilities. Then after you have that, you have to have the time to be able to practice those abilities.
Mike Zutek and Pam Lynn have been recently selected to the U.S. sailing team by the Olympic Yachting Committee of the United States. Another U.S. favorite is Pete Melvin. And silver medalist Jay Glazer finds himself in his 5th Tornado World Championship regatta. Current U.S. standings in the World Championship are Pete Melvin, number 7. P.Z. Herndon and Jay Glazer are in 13th place, having come in 3rd yesterday. Mike Zutek and Pamela Lynn of Houston are in 34th. The rest of the American contingency have fallen into 50th place or below. The Australians have taken over the lead in this regatta, and the U.S. teams are moving up. Stay tuned. We'll be back with race 5 of the 1989 Tornado Worlds in just a moment.
The top brass of the Toshima Corporation is a little concerned about their new investigator.
Crazy.
Then again, you never know when you might need a reckless, thrill-seeking renegade.
Merry Christmas.
On your side.
Tell everyone to scatter and lock down their doors. There's armed men in the building.
You must be Mr. Booker.
He's not your average company man.
This is where the fun starts.
Sunday at 6 on Fox 26.
You come on smooth.
Introducing Bud Dry.
You lead me on. You get me going, and then you're gone.
Dry brewed and cold filtered for a taste that comes on smooth. Then it's gone.
You come on smooth. And then.
So, 2 years in New York, and he thinks he can tell us how to run things.
It's all right. I fix things. He's traveling overnight on the red eye.
Not first class.
Business class, of course. Company policy.
He'll be hungry and tired.
Klung, British Airways' new business class delivers you ready for business.
Pleasant trip.
Yes, thank you.
New club class for the businessman, only from the world's favorite airline.
Jerry slammed in Galveston Island late Sunday afternoon, then headed straight up the bay and into the ship channel. The Houston Yacht Club and race officials had been watching the situation carefully, and on Sunday morning, they put out a notice for all tornado crews to take extra precaution with their boats. Masts were taken down, trampolines were removed from the boats and rolled up, and the boats were secured tightly to the ground. Some teams went so far as to take their tornado completely apart for added safety. The race officials also secured the committee boats as best they could. The eye of Hurricane Jerry swept across the yacht club Sunday evening, sinking one 38-foot sailboat, damaging 10 other yachts, and ripping planking from the piers. The debris left behind caused the postponement of the 5th race, originally scheduled for Monday. Instead of being a 7-race regatta, it will go with 6. Going into race 5, the Australian team of Goodall and Kahn are in first place. The Schwals of Germany follow at a close second. Right on their heels is the Italian boat, I-200, helmed by Giorgio Zuccoli. And fourth and fifth place are held by the French team. A brisk 15-knot wind is blowing, and the bay waters are choppy as the 71 tornadoes line up at the starting line for the 5th race of the regatta. With the winds as strong as they are, all boats are staying very clear of the line to avoid a premature start and costing them precious time or points. There's the gun, and the French boat, F-205, with Loday at the helm, scoots across the bay, heading for the first mark rounding. From there, it appears that Loday has a secure hold on the number one position. A U.S. team led by Doug Graff of Seabrook, Texas, gave the French a run for the money until the first mark rounding, when they began to drop back. Pete Melvin of the United States held the number two position through the first few legs of the race. But now on the sixth leg of the race, the Australian team of Booth and Forbes again makes their way to the front of the fleet, scooting past the Americans. The constant 15-knot winds have taken their toll on four boats. One crew retired, reason unknown. One tornado left with a broken rudder, and two left the course with torn jib sails. Back on the course, the French are still leading the Australians by almost 2 minutes, and it looks like they've mastered the same wind the Australians rode to victory on Saturday. On the last leg, the Australians make their move and begin to narrow the 2 minute lead the French have to less than 30 seconds. As they near the finish line, the Australians pull ahead and miraculously not only pass Loday and Sobin, but gain almost 30 seconds on them as they cross the finish line. This is the third win in a row for the Australians. Rough weather and winds of 22 knots and building cause officials to cancel race number six. With that announcement, the final standings of race five became the final standings for the regatta. Well, the 1989 Tornado World Championship has come to a close after five exciting races. The official race results will be made known tonight at the awards banquet. Although the unofficial results have been posted for several hours, there's an air of excitement as the awards ceremony approaches.
I have the honor of introducing the daily winners, which is fairly simple. It's simpler than it might have been. With the winner of the first race, Herb Breton and Fabrice Idier from France. Believe it or not, they won race number one. G9, Roland Gaber, Frank Carlos. The winners of races 3, 4, and 5, KA260. It's hard to read those numbers, they go so fast. Mitch Booth and John Forbes from Australia.
Reserve World Champion, Australia, KA225, Alan Goodall and Greg Pond. Come on up here. Our runner-up, World Champion, Forbes.
Fox 26 congratulates Mitch Booth and John Forbes, the new Tornado World Champions, and also congratulations to all the other competitors for our regatta well sailed. As we leave you tonight, we'd like to salute the entire international fleet that made up the 1989 Tornado World Championship. Good night.
Tornadoes on Trinity Bay, the 1989 Tornado World Championship Regatta has been brought to you by the new Bud Dry. The smooth, clean taste comes on strong, then it's gone. And by Aetna, the insurance company that gives new meaning to the word diligent. And by British Airways, with service through London to 147 cities worldwide. This is...
The conditions, what about the winds and everything?
The wind is much lighter than what we're used to sailing at home. We've been practicing for about 3 months, no less than 15 knots. We come here and it's no more than 10. So it's a bit difficult. The Europeans get a lot lighter breezes than what we do.
Yeah, go ahead, bro.
You're working harder in light air?
We are, because
you're not used to it.
We're not used to it.
Work a lot stronger. I mean, what kind of strategy do you use when you're so used to heavy air and you end up here with no breeze?
The rig's totally different. Different tuning technology and different techniques. We saw what we're given. We're not complaining, but
it'd be nice to have more wind.
It'd be nice for us to have a bit more wind.
What team do you think do well with the light air?
These guys right here.
Yeah. All the friends? Is that because they're used to it?
they are used to it, and they do a lot of what they call it, national training. With just the, all the French boats training all the time. We just don't do that because Australia's so big. We come from all over the place. We never get together unless it's a major regatta.
Yeah. Yeah, they seem to be, the function is a real tight team. You know, they seem more team oriented than anybody else out here.
Much more professional than America or Australia, New Zealand. The Germans, the French, the Italians are probably the strongest teams here, I think.
What would you guys like to play? How would you, I mean, obviously,
that win, but... Second. We can't get first, we get second. We're just looking to be top Italian right here. Not making big pieces over the win like this.
Yeah, I know it.
The funding and the coaching that the French, Italians and Germans get is... They just leave us for dead, really. You know, they're all getting funded.
Mm-hmm.
We've all got coaches here, trade boats. You know, they come and just look at every rig. We just can't get out to do that.
Yeah.
It's making it too difficult. You know,
yeah.
Their Olympic committees are spending a lot of time with them, and ours are spending none.
Because we yelled it out, and you waved twice to us.
Yes, yes, you were definitely right.
Okay.
we talked to y'all yesterday, you said that if you had a better wind, you'd do a good job. Is that what happened today?
Well, the breeze was a little bit fresher right from the start, and once we had some clean air and a bit more strength, then we got a break straight from the word go. So we're first at the first mark, and the breeze stayed into the strength we like, so we're happy.
Is there anything special that you did? I mean, nobody came near you guys. You finished 2 minutes ahead of everybody. I mean, 2 minutes ahead of second place, close to 4 minutes ahead of third, and 7 minutes ahead of fourth.
I don't know what it was. So just
we've done nothing different over the last 6 months.
No, no, we just sail like we do at home. I don't know what the difference is. We're just happy to see that wind come in.
Were you at all concerned with today being Friday the 13th? Any sailor superstition?
We've got no superstition whatsoever. There's always a sailor superstition that if you win the practice race, then you won't have any luck at all during the series. So we went and proved that wrong today. We won the practice race and we won today, so pray for some more wind.
Is that what you're hoping for the rest of the... Are you worried about the tropical depression that's out there? Do you think that's
gonna... We hope it gets a lot closer, so it brings a lot more wind for us.
we're really waiting for it. Yeah, really hoping that it comes up and provides a lot of...
Well, if it's, even if it's...
If it's like that for the rest of the week, of course we'll be happy. But we wouldn't mind... But if it increases, that... be just as good.
Yeah. What about, how long have you guys been sailing together?
About 4 months.
At all?
Yeah.
That's
John,
great.
John's been sailing tornadoes for about 4 or 5 years, and I've been sailing them for about 11 years, and we've only just recently teamed up together.
What do you like about the tornado over other boats?
The competition.
the closeness in competition.
Really?
Yeah. It's a most competitive catamaran by a long way, and I just enjoy sailing catamarans.
Who do you think, obviously besides y'all, are the biggest competition out here? Who are you worried about seeing on off your stern?
I think the French and the Italians and the Germans, because of their training campaigns over the last year or so, they're really going to be tough to beat. There's lots of them going real fast. If the breeze lightens up any less than what it was today, then we're going to have some problems with all of them.
And there's not just one of them. There's like 5 French and 4 Italians and 6 Germans, and they're all going really, really quick.
Do you think that because they had the French, I guess, either race 1 or race 2, their coach towed them out, do you think that gave them any kind of an advantage?
No, we don't think so. We're talking about it'd be nice to have a coach boat. But, we haven't had a coach boat ever, so it doesn't really worry us. We just live with it. It's not part of the race, so it's just makes it a bit easier to get out there, that's all.
When we were out here earlier, like before the races started and pre-races, there seemed to be sort of a sense of camaraderie around here, and now that seems to be lessening. Does that happen as the regatta goes on? Do you start to get a little tougher towards each other?
Definitely gets more serious.
As the points narrow down to a certain few who are leading the regatta, it just tends to get a little tense towards the end. When the deciding stages of the regatta come around. But we're just here for a good time.
No, you're not. You're here to win.
No, we're here for a good time.
We had our good time last week.
We've been trying to win for 11 years. Now's the time to have a good time.
Okay, great.
Thank you. be the first one. He's got his back twice. So the boat's going to roll him. These boats are going to roll him before he... I think this boat out here is probably going to get him. Yeah, this is the lead boat right here. First boat around the mark is KZ61 at 89. I-200, KA-260.
Got him going around.
The start for us was not so good. We didn't start too well. We were in about the fourth row, and luckily we were on the right end of the line, so we tacked as soon as we could, got some clean wind, and middle of the first leg, we were looking all right again. But wish we could get the start right.
were you first around the first mark?
I think we were about 10th, the first mark, and then just slowly worked our way up to about 4th, where we stayed for about a third of the race. And then the wind started shifting left to right, so we picked some shifts, luckily, and we're in first at the next mark. So, and the wind picked up again.
And it stayed there. I forgot what the question was. Do you think somebody was talking about your boat today? Because I commented to them about how well you had done. And they said, well, it's that boat's perfect, you know, for this kind of weather and everything. What is it about your boat that's making it?
Well, the boat is actually quite old, and it's not really the state of the art when you look at some of the new boats, although the rig, as you've probably seen, is a little bit different in the shape of the profile of the mainsail. Other than that, our boat's no different to anyone. You know, it's nearly 4 years old, and a lot of them are new.
The shape of your sails helping a lot?
In these conditions, I think it's ideal. But in the lighter breeze, there's still some development needed to really make the rig efficient.
Catch of the day, good for you. Our watch, KA260 to G896.
Okay, 699 is in view, turning around. And here comes, all right, 260. Dum, 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 dum,
be hard to tell if it's neck and neck with U.S.
65, right.
Yeah. Who's going to get to the mark first? It looks like U.S.
Right.
U.S. marks it. U.S. is second.
Hey.
Whoa, they don't fall over.
It is, yeah. Australia, 260.
260.
Yep. No, it's not good at all. It's the guys that came in first the 2 days.
Forbes.
Away they go.
This is flag 9.
have to give her the time, Carl, because I don't have the approval.
Not really. This
is rounding number 9.
This is good. I'm getting it all. Two shot. French is around. Australia is around.
Okay, head to the right a little, to the right.
Got him. Where's our third place?